डॉक्टर शशांक, बच्चों को और उनको जल्दी से भेजिए मैसेज जरा, सो दैट वी कैन स्टार्ट विद द एट 3 o'clock शार्प. ओके डॉक्टर पटनायक, प्लीज सेंड मैसेज टू द स्टूडेंट्स टू ज्वाइन एट द अर्लीस्ट. डॉक्टर पीएस राय, गुड इवनिंग सर.
वेरी गुड इवनिंग. यस,
आई एम डॉक्टर सुनील, एसोसिएट डीन एंड हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनवायरमेंट साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी.
थैंक यू फॉर द इनविटेशन.
Yeah, sir, we have with us our senior most professor, Professor V.K. Garg, also,
very good afternoon.
Also Dean Student Welfare of the...
Yes, Namaskar.
Garg, sir, aapka mic mute hai. Sir, Garg, sir, aapka mic, yes.
Namaskar, sir, Namaskar.
Namaskar, Namaskar.
Garg, sir. Yes, sir.
प्रोफेसर का
सर,
एक बार अभी साहब को एक कॉल करके देख लीजिए इफ ही इज अवेलेबल, अदरवाइज
मैंने नहीं उठा रहे अभी.
नहीं उठा रहे हैं. ओके Sir, we'll wait for 2-3 minutes more and then we will start with it.
No issue, no issue.
Students are joining.
Yeah, no issue.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Yes.
Very good afternoon. How is the situation in your campus, Mittal Sahab?
Sir, situation, actually we have allowed the students to come to the campus, but very few students have come to the campus. Very few.
Okay.
Students, only PhD scholars are coming. Others are not coming.
Otherwise, in our district, Bathinda, there is no such panic, only 5 to 10 cases every day
okay.
coming. So, not a much worse situation, we can say.
And your research scholars are there in the campus or?
Yes, sir. PhD scholars are there in the campus.
Okay, good, good, good.
Only sciences, not the arts one.
Okay.
Sir, should we start now? I think so.
We can start.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Shashank, please start with the today's program.
Okay. Very good afternoon to everyone. To start up with, let us all rise for the university anthem. Respected Professor R.P. Tiwari, sir, Vice Chancellor of Central University of Punjab, Bathinda. Respected Professor P.S. Roy, sir, distinguished guest for today's lecture. Professor V.K. Garg, sir, Dean Student Welfare and Senior Professor of our school. Dr. Sunil Mittal, Associate Dean of our school. Dr. J.K. Patnaik, HOD, Department of Geology. Faculty of Environmental Science and Technology, Geology, Geography, and various faculty from our department, from other department, dear students and other esteemed participants who are present today. We are very delighted to Professor P.S. Roy, sir, for accepting our humble request invitation in spite of your busy schedule, sir. Professor P.S. Roy will be delivering on the topic Frontier Research in Geoinformatics. With this, I invite Professor V.K. Garg, sir, Dean Student Welfare and Senior Professor of a School for the Welcome Address, sir.
Yeah, thank you. A very good afternoon to all of you. First of all, I welcome Professor Raghavendra P. Tiwari ji, Vice Chancellor, Central University of Punjab. I also welcome Professor Partha Sarthi Roy ji. He is a well-known person. I think he doesn't need any introduction. And if keep on speaking about him, whatever I'll speak, that will be less about him. I also welcome our Associate Dean, Dr. Sunil Mittal, HODs of different departments and faculty members of different departments to this very important topic that has been chosen for today's talk to be delivered by Professor Partha Sarthi Roy. And the topic of his talk is Frontier Research in Geoinformatics. As far as Professor Partha Sarthi is concerned, he is having a very long experience, I think more than 40 years experience of working in the field of sciences. Professor Roy, a professional in earth observation science, vegetation science, land use, land change, biodiversity, and climate science. So he has worked all his life on these different fields. And he has worked more than 30 years with Indian Space Research Organization, ISRO. And he has worked as director of Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, that is at Dehradun. Presently, Professor Roy is working as chair professor at the University of Hyderabad. And he is senior advisor presently he is also senior fellow of World of India. He is having more than 300 publications to his credit that every scientist dream to be, and his citations are somewhere in the range of 8 to 10,000, maybe more than that, and his H index is 47. Recently, you might be knowing that one list of the scientists that was by a scientist of Stanford University, Professor John, was circulating in India, that was containing the names of the scientists. Those are in the top of the world in that list. So Professor Roy was also in that list that is published by the Stanford University. So sir, this is our pleasure. And this is a great moment for us to have you here. And I have full faith and belief that whatever you will speak for next 1 hour or so, that is going to benefit my faculty and to my students. And certainly their brain is going to get free for next, at least for 2 days, to think whatever. Sir, I again welcome you to the Central University of Punjab. Actually, we wanted you to be in offline mode in our university, physically be present here for a week or so and talk to our students. But you know that due to this pandemic and that all, we couldn't do that. But I'm sure in the coming days, whenever the situation will improve, we will be more than happy to have you at the Central University of Punjab. Rinda, sir, I again welcome you to this webinar. Yes. Over to Dr.
Dr. Sashank?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please carry on.
Okay. Thank you, Vinod sir. Now I welcome Professor Partha P.S. Roy sir for your expert lecture, sir.
I request all to mute their mics.
Yeah, it is just I will share my screen.
Yes, sir.
So hopefully everything will go well. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. Isko thoda full kar lijiye.
Yes, yes, I will do that.
Yes, sir. It's good.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So, Basically, the topic on which I will be talking is a already introduced is a frontier research in geoinformatics. In the outset, I must thank the Vice Chancellor of Central University Punjab, Bhatinda, for kindly inviting me for being a speaker on this occasion, and also for the my introduction, which I don't know whether I really deserve. The senior professors and faculty members of the school, and also the dear students who are attending this talk. Well, my talk is divided into three portions. Initially, I will take you to different milestones, how the remote sensing and geoinformatics has reached, and then take you to contemporary science of geoinformatics, its evolution in the present state, and then future trends. Especially, I will show you some case example and also some of the major milestones which we have achieved in India, and particularly in especially to make available the remote and GIS database. Just before I go to my talk, I thought it will be most appropriate to take you back in 1854, which may be called as a very primitive type of GIS emergence in true sense. There was an epidemic cholera in London city in 1854, and people were wondering how this cholera has spreading in the city. So one of the doctors, who was known as a Dr. John Snow, he plotted the cases of the cholera on a map of the city, and found very interesting things that all cholera cases are along the local water wells, and most of the cholera deaths were from the contaminated pump which was distributing water supply to this. So, and he concluded that this particular is spreading through a leakage from the somewhere leakage into the pump, and that's how the entire problem of cholera epidemic was solved. So it was a very simplistic representation, and all geoinformatics people trace back to the GIS emergence, wherein the cholera cases are put on a map and you find out the cause of cholera looking at the visual perception of the association of features. In the recent era of GIS, or in other terms, geoinformatics, I will differentiate this term little later. There is a small difference between GIS and geoinformatics, but then at the moment I will use together this term. So Mac Haug was basically is called as a father of GIS, and he came to United States after the Second World War to get a master's degree in 1952, and 1954 he took a professor of landscape architecture and regional planning in the University of Architecture in Pennsylvania. People who are in the geography field, they may be aware importance of regional planning, which we emphasize for development as one of the primary in the development strategy. So he was also, it may be most appropriate to mention here that he is also mentioned as a as an environmentalist who coined the day of Earth Day in 1970. And basically, since then, Earth Day is celebrated. So basically, is a kind of work which he worked and showed how in different layers of information can be used. And he took an example of a geography where the mining work was going on, and after that, resettlement and reclamation of the mining areas. So, mostly these reclamations are very, very arbitrary, and people do not follow the landform. He postulated a theory that any landform modification must be follow function of the landscape which is present there. Like valley is mostly for cultivation, the undulating uplands is for the tree cover forest, and the unforested plateau should be for settlement, purely settlement. So this kind of a concept was evolved under him, and he used a kind of a map technology which were available during that time, where unforested plateau where the settlements is planned, and the forested plateau where the mixing of the settlement with the trees, and the finally forested valley wall which prevents the erosion and soil erosion and runoff from the top hill. So what he did, he marked these areas on a cadastral maps, detailed cadastral maps, the landforms, and then demarcated the area, what should be kept for valley, and what should be the forested area, and what should be left to the urban settlement. This is a map which he produced, and this he began the first person to use an integrated approach in development. And basically that time computer technologies were not there. So acetate layer overlays, these are very old method of transparent sheets, and three transparent sheets were overlapped on the cadastral base map. One of the physiography, another one on the forest cover and vegetation cover and the settlement. Gradually this tool was taken to the academics, and we all should express our gratitude to the grand professor. Today he is at age of 78, Professor Michael Goodchild. He, I don't know whether you have seen that three volumes of book on fundamentals of GIS is a very popular book, and it is a kind of used as a textbook for that. He was associated with the National Center for Geographic Information and Analysis, and he introduced the course of GIS in University of California, Santa Barbara. And these efforts fueled a quantitative revolution and where the world of geographic science, and laid the groundwork of digital form of geoinformation in 1963. And from that time, this technology was used, GIS and geoinformatics, in synonym. So it became a part of informatics technology. So GIS projects gain recognition in the academic community as a new way of doing spatial analysis and the planning. Roger Tomlinson actually was the first person who started developing, building computerized software on GIS, and he was associated with Canadian government, and then later on he moved to the Tomlinson created a design of automated computing to store, process large amount of data. And this was a kind of a file keeping or bookkeeping exercise on the land management program. What is new? Actually, GIS computer software package, and it is an important for the cartographer, almost like a writer for word processing. Information system is a method of spatially storing. That means maps can be converted into digital form. Analyzing it, you can store many maps and overlay one map with the other to do analysis. You can update or manipulate the maps, manage it according to requirements. That means you can change the projection, you can change the color scheme, depending on the kind of a emphasis which you want to lay down. And then finally, most important is displaying geographical data on a computer. Today, it is in multi-dimensional domain, you can display the data. And thus, this technology became a very, very friendly technology for all earth scientists, natural resource management, environmentalists, archaeologists, architects, and so forth. And today, every field today touches the use of geographic information system or geographic and geoinformatics. The modern GIS started with the Harvard Laboratory, where, during this period, US and Western countries were having a revolutionary techniques in the software development and also in the hardware development of this thing. And the computer graphics laboratory developed first software on GIS is a SciMap. And it also became a research center for spatial analysis and visualization. Many of the early concept of GIS and its applications were conceived at this lab. And it also produced very talented geographers and planners, computer scientists, and they developed this particular discipline. Many of you must be heard about Mark Dangermond. So basically, he took this. He is a student of Harvard lab, and he took this particular technology as a commercial domain. And first software was launched in ArcInfo and as a commercial product in 1981. So Jack Dangermond formed a company along with his wife, Laura, both a student of Harvard University and particularly this lab. And they were member of this Harvard lab. And today, one of the most popular software, which is has originated from Environmental System Research Institute, ISRI, is called as a ArcGIS. And there are after that, there are many commercial softwares which were came in market. ArcGIS, GeoMedia, which is basically produced by Hexagon, and so on and so forth. But leading software is still being used as ArcGIS, which is produced by US. This development followed a very important development for the academics. There were Open GIS Geospatial Consortium was formed, and which helped because anything produced in ArcGIS should be interoperable. You should be able to create from this file, files taken from one GIS software to another GIS software, so that people can make use of it. So people defined the standard and the registry system, also defined the protocols for the file system. And during this particular body, international body, made a very significant contribution for spreading the GIS technology among the academia and the researchers. I will consider another milestone on the development of GIS is a open source opportunities. Most of these softwares which I talked to you, they are commercial software and highly costly. Their updates are very difficult to be for a normal university to upgrade them. So there was a parallel movement by the academicians to develop a open source GIS software, which could be a kind of a tool in the hand of students and GIS researchers. And among them, I will mention the GRASS and QGIS. They are very popular. GRASS was among the first one, which was developed by US Defense Department for storage, but later on they released this particular software for open source. And QGIS is also, it's a kind of group of open source enthusiasts, and this software is also developed today operationally. And today, whatever you can do and whatever you need as a student and researcher for in GIS, that is available in QGIS. You need not to look at the commercial software. Almost same time, the internet came, and the people wanted to disseminate their data. So open source GIS software available to disseminate the information in the web. And there are many softwares which were available, which could be used for building the database on the internet and disseminating and sharing with the research interest group. GeoServer is one of the very popular open source server tool which shares geospatial data. You can take open and free data out of this. So today where we stand, two, three things. The mainframe computers gave way to the desktop and the laptop and very small computer systems. Even mobiles today is a small form of computer. So this gave to a new domain and which started uncovering meaning insights of within the data, and you started building the information, knowledge and wisdom within the new framework and process of understanding. And this was championed by some of the pioneers who were in developing the GIS software. Today, especially when in beginning of 2000, we started talking about three important technologies: nanotechnology, biotechnology, and geotechnology. And it is geotechnology which started giving benefits to the geographic information scientists, and it has a promise today to revolutionize its application in all the fields where we will see that which touches the human civilization. This geotechnology is supported by three important components: global positioning system, which gives you locations, remote sensing, and then geographic information technology per se, which is, so it builds a spatial triad of three technologies: GPS, GIS, and remote sensing. And you can build the global information, and that's how today the global Google Earth is a one classic example where we all look for where what is located. It involves precise placement, delineation of physical features. It can also can give me ability to predict modeling. I can choose my pathways where I will have a least traffic congestion to reach the particular point. So it also can give me a different route. It may be a shorter route, or you can give a faster route, you can choose. So that kind of options were available by this technology. And so you can ask many questions: why, so what, and what if, that kind of questions you can ask. So as on today, what we stand, we devote a lot of time in data conversion and attribute tagging and spatial analysis. This particular thing is changing very fast. Last 2 years particularly has revolutionized the data, spatial data conversion techniques. There are many free available data sources. Attributing, it has become easier, and data conversion is become a very small component of it. And thus, the data is becoming a part of analytics. And with its movement to web and cloud computing, and its integration with the real-time information through Internet of Things, which is called as IoT, and GIS become a platform which is most relevant of human endeavor, and especially for the acts as a nervous system of the planet. Today, some of you must have heard about big data in a very simplistic term, where the data becomes a very large size, needs a huge computing process, and it has a kind of a information, knowledge, and wisdom. And basically, it is today being talked about a kind of a convergence of technologies. So GIS also has become a kind of a convergence of technologies and forms an important big data tool. In this, important tools are cartography, geodesy, geography, the fundamental science and technology, subjects, physics, mathematics, and broadband networks, GPS, remote sensing, satellite, aerial, and maybe drone kind of thing. GIS per se, information communication technology, mobile, photogrammetry, and total station ground search. So all these technologies can converge and provide you information which basically gives you solutions for the. So I will spend a little bit of time on the futuristic part, where we are talking about big data from space. And this is where the whole revolution has taken place in last 10 years. You can imagine that zettabyte information, it was a less than 20 in 2010. In this single decade, today we have 175 zettabyte data. And the growth of this data has been tremendous. Let us see what has made possible. One of the important mission which has contributed in this is a Landsat mission, is the NASA launch mission. And initially it was up Landsat up 1 to 5. It was fully operated by NASA, but now it is a participatory of the US has got into it. So once the satellite is launched by the NASA and their launch vehicles, it takes US takes over, and US processes the data. And one of the most important thing is today, 9 satellites continuously from 1972 onwards to till today, 9 satellites are providing a continuous data sets. Not only that, these data sets are available today in level 2 and level 3 science products. When we call it a science product, means it is used for scientific investigation by making a geometrically comparable data sets, projection wise, giving a liquidity in projections. It also gives you a kind of a radiometric balancing between a mission 1 to mission 2. That means satellite of launched in 1972 can be compared with the Landsat 9, which is launched in 2020. And they are available as a Landsat analysis ready data on highest scientific standard placed in tile-based structure. You can go to the USGS site and freely download this data from 1972 till today. Barring the cloud cover seasons, you have the entire globe data available, and you can use any year, any month of the data of any geographical region of world. Another important mission which has created this kind of opportunity is European Space Agency, and this is about very recent one, Copernicus program, which is a joint initiative of European Union and European Space Agency. And with the climate becoming more important, the meteorological satellites, which is launched by EUMETSAT, is also become a part of this Copernicus programs. And they are each member states of European Space Agency contributes their specialized missions into this Copernicus program. Now, give you an example, the disciplines which it addresses is the climate change, marine monitoring, atmospheric monitoring, land monitoring, security, and emergency management. Emergency management, especially disaster, cyclone, drought, earthquake, pre and post scenarios. Likewise, there are many disasters, and these numbers of disasters have been increasing with the human interventions and also the climate change. Just briefly, I will not go into detail. The Sentinel family of satellite observe our land, ocean, and atmosphere from a composite set of data sets. So it provides you information in the microwave region. It provides you information on the optical region. It provides you information on the surface topography, especially for the terrain mapping. It provides you information on the atmosphere. Recently, there was a satellite which is aerosol and trace gas. This thing, Sentinel-5, gives you air quality monitoring, solar radiation, and Sentinel-6 for the oceanographic missions. So beauty is that all these satellites, they have a kind of a common geometrical framework. So stitching the data and overlaying the data becomes very easy when you have a technology like this. It also supported by some more science missions of European Space Agency, especially PLSDOS NEO. Basically, it is a kind of a satellite which is almost similar to Landsat, but increases the reach cycle. Then the 50 centimeter high resolution data, 90 centimeter, 1.5 meter, various kind of radar constellation and disaster management constellations. So when we say constellations, that means these satellites has the ability of almost giving everyday data, that one satellite passes and second satellite passes the neighboring area. Likewise, these 4-5 satellites cover the geographical area and provide you daily data of the giving information, which is very crucial in disaster related activity. Another important thing which has happened with the US and European Union, and India is also part of it, is a global presentation constellation of satellites. Again, this mission, their various missions, they are scientific missions, share their scientific details, and it is possible to build a precipitation a map of the globe in 2.5 days. So every 2.5 days, maximum rainfall area can be built. There is another new technology is coming from the space platform. It is not there at the moment, but from the drone platform and the aerial platform, this kind of data is in plenty. From the space platform, there are very few satellites which were there, but they were also experimental satellite by the American satellites. Like any technology, when it becomes in a state of use and where things become a commercial importance, so obviously there is a commercial domain to it, and people have started moving towards the commercial domain, and the high resolution, very high resolution remote sensing data in the region of something like about starting from 1 meter to 0.3 meter, data sets are now available. Anybody can buy these data sets through certain mechanism. And you started here, and if you see the kind of a growth which is taking place today, from 2010 onwards, it has taken a trajectory which seems to be a uncontrollable, and today huge data is available. And these satellites, they are to give you details, 0.82 ground resolution, 2.65 QuickBird, the 0.4 satellite GOI, the WorldView 1, WorldView 2, and WorldView 3 is a 0.3 centimeter data set. So these satellites, they have a capability of giving information of 0.3 centimeter of the ground detail, where you can build a car human moving, spacecraft moving, the tank, and many other application and strategic applications, and also civilian applications can be done using this. So one of the important thing which has happened, that all this spaceborne data is now available on a cloud platform in many of the data set, except for the very high resolution data sets. They are available on a common cloud platform. I will come to that, and you can use this cloud platform not only for getting the data, also use the data. Another important development which has taken place is a unmanned aerial vehicles. And on unmanned vehicles, you can mount, take pictures, and using any sensor systems, starting from microwave to hyperspectral, and these data sets are becoming very, very important. Now, all these data sets, what we do today, we create in a computerized domain so that we can do a complex data modeling. It has a map, it has a table, it has a mix ability to mix the map and the tabular information into complex data modeling platforms. And there is a possibility of doing interactive mapping. That means you can visualize the satellite data, you do the interactive mapping online using this. Third option is available today. You can integrate this data, which I showed you, which was done for the land, physiographic land use, land development. So you can use in computer domain, you can overlay the geographic, physiographic map, the settlement map, the land use map, and then design your own plan for a regional plan or development plan. You can visualize the data in 3D and also do the modeling using this. One of the important thing which is being done today, data, there are tools which are available which can convert this data into information. When I say tools, they are available as a kind of a model, inbuilt model in the computer. You have to put your data and use this tool to convert the information. I will show you some examples in Indian condition. So now the entire technology is moving into direction of where you can the theories, physical principles, mathematical theories, physical theories can be applied. Like rivers, you can create a river network, and then you can determine the flows of the river based on the slope and the topography of the area. You can define the patterns and the spatial patterns. You can differentiation of the objects, the diffusion process of like pollution in the water bodies, in the air. You can have a mathematical model, and then from the point source, you can measure the dispersion, how it is taking place. So and so forth. There are many, many applications which are now getting like spatial interactions, any event which has got so many social and socioeconomic interactions. These interactions also can be mapped using the spatial information. Connectivity, which is very visible today in network, in the Google Earth Maps. And you can see the connectivity, road network, and the traffic congestion and all that. And also, we are able to see, visualize this through connections. And when we see that, we don't know what is in the background. It is almost kind of a, it has become a seamless technology. When we see, as for example, Google Earth, we don't know from where the satellite data comes and what are the resolution. We just go on increasing the resolution and we see the detail and which flow continuously flow in a seamless manner. And we also can communicate the data from one place to another place through mobile techniques, or if a group discussion, you can have a kind of a chat room where you can online classes are very big, popular. Likewise, there are a kind of a data collaboration and communication is taking place, and this helps in building a common understanding of the problem. Another area which will be basically evolving, many of the countries are building up this data, where you have a kind of a external and internal data sets and basically information to knowledge incorporation. So there is the attribute data, object data, and speech data. And these data sets pass through a continuous process of data management, like data updation, the enrichment of the data, filling the gap of the data. So these kind of thing, continuous process goes on. And then you also have some kind of a models of traffic flow, the liquid, the fluid dynamics flow, especially on the river, this thing. So these models also sit along with the data management part, and then it builds you a kind, gives you a knowledge of, and this knowledge is passed, shared to the decision makers immediately. Like I will give you an example here. Biodiversity information system provides you information about the forest cover and each forest or kind of a condition they are, whether how much they are fragmented, whether how much disturbance is there, whether people are dependent on this for firewood, for grazing. These kind of information, areas which have a low regeneration. So these kind of information systems can be done. So it has a major component of database server, data management, application server, application software, and then a kind of a hardware. In this process, we know that mobile wireless technology is also becoming very important. And we all communicate today using the web services, using from tablet to the pocket PC to the a smartphone, and then come back to the desktop. And then it goes back to the centralized data repositories, and we can again put on the web for applications. Another new things which is already in available, and you can have a sensor which remotely measuring it. Like in India, you have automatic weather stations. In last 5 years, something like about 300 times number of weather stations have increased. Now, these weather stations, they are real-time data they are giving about the temperature, humidity, the rainfall, and all these kind of information real-time and coming into the IMD, India Meteorological Department. And it has a drastically improved the weather forecasting today. Similarly, there are many applications, agriculturists, they are doing using this kind of a technology to measure the soil fertility, soil moisture, crop health, these kind of information. So today we have seen where a simple technology to today, we are moving towards distributed geoprocessing and spatial analysis. This distributed GIS means there are freedom of data you can use, find any kind of a data in the web, and mix with your data to add value. It could be a scientific value, it could be commercial value, it could be a social or economic value. And that kind of a simplistic example could be soil moisture, crop sowing, rainfall pattern, and NDVIs that can available in different platform. And what we do not download this data. We only independently use this data together in the in application domain, and then visualize and provide this data from. This is an emerging area where lot of development which is taking place. Cloud computing, I have mentioned to you, it is a very operational today in other disciplines. Many people, most of us, we work from home. It is possible from cloud. And cloud is nothing but it's a virtual domain of computing systems, and we use in seamless manner these computing systems. But in GIS, this particular thing is coming today, and I will show you example how this happens. Happens through a kind of a, one of the application is a crowdsourcing of GIS input. Earlier, basically in-house, outsource, we used to outsource in different agencies and get the data. But today, people in the field with a simple mobile technology, they can pass on the information on your server, which will have a locational positional accuracy, and it will have a detail, it will have a photograph of the area, and then it uses internet camera, GPS, and the picture. So this information is has been used widely for the disaster management, like in case of earthquake, cyclone, or disseminating the information using the crowd. So there are some of the directions which is basically now the social media has become very important. Socio-economic and the sustainability components, they are now getting built up in the decision-making process. And instead of a kind of a data sets individually flowing through individual to individual, now it is processed through a team table where the all knowledge is built up and it passes on to the decision makers. I will give you one example of cloud computing, especially it's called the Google Earth Engine. It has many satellite data together. It has been brought at a common platform. And the most beauty part is that these data sets, most of them are free. It is in a planetary scale, that is Earth, entire Earth is covered. Free cloud processing inbuilt. You can process the entire data sets in the massive online public data archive. Upload your own data onto this. Let them take care of version control and flexible access to the APIs. There are floating APIs, which are some are cost basis and some are freely available. And these data sets can be processed in this. So what are available in this Google Earth? Landsat, all Landsat data from Landsat 2 to Landsat 9, MODIS data, terrain data, land cover data by produced by various agencies, global data, atmospheric data. So, and something like about more than five petabyte data is available today. And every day, something like 4,000 new images are being added to it. You can do a suite of geospatial processing on the using the simple options which are available on the computer, and the 1,000 data types and operators are and these are basically growing. How you do it? Get the image, put a algorithm, classify it, then use a complete, take a large volume of data, and from large volume of data, you build out a kind of a data set which is useful to you, and then map algorithm over the collection of the data sets which you have taken and reduce the collection, and then do the algorithm operation on this. So you calculate the statistics, classification, all these things can be done using this kind of a platforms. And they are actually being used extensively by many scientists today, and especially it can be useful tool for the students in the where they have they don't have access to the huge computer software requirements. It also helps you to get the data freely. Like any other discipline, artificial intelligence is also going to play a very important role in the area. And basically, the neural network, especially back propagation neural network, and looking at the past trends, you can predict the future, what will happen. So these kind of a, and if you have classified an area for 10 years, and can you predict a new map using the artificial intelligence? Basically, you're looking at the data trend and the neighborhood criteria. Now, I will give you two examples because time may not permit me to cover all the applications. I will give you one application which is uses a kind of a multi-source data in a distributed system, like biological data, field data, social data, and physical data. What kind of biological data? Forest, non-forest, it comes from FSI. For vegetation type map, which is prepared by X agency, broad vegetation cover type, this is classified, simplified. The field data collects on species richness, biodiversity value, the uniqueness or endemism of the species. They come from taxonomists working in the field, or the field scientists, or maybe community or the students working with them. This field data is also put in this data. Then social settlement, road connectivity, the sources of population density, the settlement, physical information, these information comes into, and through proximity analysis, and you can determine the disturbance, and then determine disturbance gets into a model of predicting biological richness. And you ultimately, you have a kind of a map from the field data, you can predict biological richness. And this has been done for India in 2012 and COP11, this particular comprehensive data sets have been, which is in the size of 1 terabyte data, has been released using a SPLAM software, which is called as a spatial landscape analysis model. So it uses a data set, develops a model of its own in mathematical models, and these mathematical models are used for prediction of biological richness or nationwide. Another example I will show you, which is during in ICRISAT, it was done where mobile, you have information via C2 sensors, agriculture field, satellite navigation, and computer system. And you also have real-time data on the from drone. This entire data sets are brought to the farmer or the person who is managing the crop, which uses GPS with the position, and it uses a kind of a bus information to release the pesticide or irrigation part or seed distribution using the internet communication system. And there is a RFID frequency, this thing. So basically, in the entire field, you do not have disease. So wherever disease is there, you can take the drones and spread the pesticide. This kind of applications are many private agencies are offering today in Punjab, in Haryana, and many part of the country. It helps in a monitoring of the health, increase of production, and also monitors the observations of the. This is my last slide, which I will throw up some of the challenges to the young colleagues of mine, friends of mine, students of the various courses who are undertaking. There are some areas where the research opportunities are tremendous. The temporal analysis, you know that climate is changing. So what kind of a changes it is bringing in glaciers, in agriculture fields, in the forest, in the oceans? This is a important area of research. The another area with the change in the climate, disasters, frequency of disasters are increasing. So geographic information system is emerging as a very important information to provide you risk map, the and the mobilization techniques, the so that you can reach the help to needy people. It also helps you in determining the loss and compensate the loss through insurance policies. There are areas where the archaeology today, many of the past civilizations can be monitored using GIS and remote sensing technique. And here, the textual data, that means text data, which is stored in the historical documents, are being integrated into the GIS domain. And in the field of archaeology, it is being used. Artificial intelligence is a mutual meeting and passing point. This is again a new area. And finally, in computing side, processing and strategies for the big spatial data, that is those people who are interested in building the models, for computing models, that is again data analytics discipline, data science and data analytics. It provides an excellent opportunity. I think with this, I will end here and leave this session for questions, if any.
Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful lecture. And it was a pleasure, sir, listening to you. I hope the students, faculty member, and all the participants will be highly benefited from this lecture. Our participants for today are from students, master's students, PhD, and young faculty. So I believe that they must have some questions to ask. So I open the time one by one. Quickly, you can ask your questions. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir.
Sir, can you stop your presentation, sir?
I will stop that presentation.
May I ask a question?
Yes, go ahead. You can introduce yourself first.
Good afternoon, sir. Myself, Amandeep Singh. I am a PhD student of Geography Department.
Very good.
Yes, sir. I am working on rural health and healthcare facilities in Bathinda district.
Yeah.
Sir, I want to know how it is GIS helpful to in health and healthcare facilities to use and present show present scenario of health and healthcare facilities, and how to use LZU land use led cover in the present scenario, sir.
Okay, so there are two part of your question, especially on health sector, rural health sector, how this technology can be helped. So in the present scenario, it is mobile applications are being used to see your the cases, register the cases, and it also helps in directing the cases to the nearest hospital or medical facilities. So those medical facilities, whether they, what kind of a, whether it is a COVID hospital or non-COVID hospital, based on that, it is being directed, people are using it for directing the people to the right place in a very short time. Second thing is, in a broader concept, health GIS is a subject of great research. I will give you an example. In Gorakhpur, encephalitis, a disease, is occurred during immediately after the monsoon season. This encephalitis disease takes place in certain land use places and land cover places, and it also is association with socioeconomic conditions. So it identifies the risk areas and the vulnerable areas so that the primary health centers can take care, focus, concentration on that area. Similarly, malaria, encephalitis, the filariasis, the other communication diseases also are being monitored using the health GIS. As far as the land use, land cover information, there are two of information which is prepared. One is globally prepared. So today, if you go to the Google Earth engine, you will find a 30 meter land use, land cover map of the entire globe. Similarly, the Indian data is also available. That is on Bhuvan. Bhuvan site is there of ISRO. You can access and send your request to geographical data of small area.
Thank you very much, sir. So one thing is more, can you suggest to me some geostatics models for statistical data?
CART is one model which is available where regression of between the layers is used for classification, and it is freely available on Google Earth Engine. It is a geostatistical data.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions?
Good afternoon, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Sir, my name is Garima Jasrotia. I am a PhD research scholar in the Department of Geography, Central University of Punjab. During your presentation, you mentioned something about level 2 and level 3 data. Can you shed some more light on that? What is that and how do we utilize it? Or what's the differentiation? How do we categorize the data?
Okay. So the science data is called as a level 2 and level 3 data. Level 2 is a geometric rectification. That means the data is ready to put on a particular geographical map, which is with certain projection, which is it can sit on a map straight away. And a level 3 product is a radiometrically corrected data, so that if you are using a Lancet 9 or Lancet 8 and of time 1, yeah. So and other your data you are using for ATs of that is Lancet 4 or Lancet 5, both will have different sensors, but radiometrically they will be different. So level 3 corrects the radiometry and brings in a common radiometric level, so that you can, if you are doing a land use change detection, that data can be used for classification using single algorithm.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay, is there anyone else? Any question?
Yeah, Sunil Mittal, I think, raised his hand.
Okay. Okay, if there is none, then...
So, sir, it was a wonderful lecture. And I think so it will be very helpful for our students. I came across many new things through in this lecture, though we all are teaching remote sensing and GIS in our subjects in all the three, environment science, yeah, geology, as well as geography. Yeah. And planning to start even a new course, especially PG diploma in geoinformatics.
Great. Very nice. Nice to hear that.
Yes, sir. And I hope this all will be very helpful. And as our honorable Professor V.K. Garg has told us to invite you for physical lectures here. We hope the COVID will go at the earliest, go away, and we will be able to call you for your expert lectures in our campus physically. Sir, thank you so much. I request Dr. Shashank for a formal note of thanks.
Okay. So it was my pleasure to deliver this particular talk, and I have been to your campus once in a recruitment you have a beautiful campus, and it was coming up during that time, so any future opportunity, it will be my pleasure.
I think so, sir. You visited our old campus. That was just an rented building.
It was selection that time. Your earlier VC, I forget his name.
Professor R.P. Kohli?
R.P. Kohli, he was there.
That time we were in our old campus, sir.
Achha, you have now moved to new campus. Okay.
We have now moved to new campus. It is a lush green 500 acres campus.
Okay, great.
And all the new buildings, all new labs, everything new. So.
Great. Great.
Yes. Okay, Dr. Shashank, please.
Yes. Okay, thank you so much, sir, once again for that wonderful lecture. And then the students in our department comprises of students from third semester as well as from first semester, as well as PhD, who are in the process of establishing their research in geography, taking the geospatial technology. So I feel that the lecture that you have made is the need of the hour at this time for the students, because they are preparing their synopsis, some are preparing their seminars. So I think this is a very good lecture that you have given to us today, sir. And we believe that in the future, we will once again meet you, and then you will guide us in all the things that is possible, sir.
It will be my pleasure, and I really appreciate the kind of enthusiasm has been shown by young faculty of geography department, and all the students who have participated in this. It is a great pleasure for me.
To wind up, we will rise up for national anthem, but since my power has gone out, sir, soon, Dr. Sunil, sir, can you please play the national anthem because I'm doing it from my mobile, so I cannot play it, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I can stop it now.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Okay.